Family, friends, citizens of Auburn, it's an honor to stand before you tonight as your mayor. I thank you for joining us to mark the start of a new chapter in the history of our community. I want to begin by recognizing members of our community that are not here this evening. First, to the man whose words of encouragement led to my decision to seek this office, my grandfather. A man grounded in his faith and his commitment to family, the steady advice he offered throughout my childhood as I grew up in this very neighborhood and until this fall helped to shape the man I am today. On election day, as many of us gathered at the polls and celebrated victories to elected office, he began his transition out of this world. And though his absence tonight leaves a hole in my heart, I remain as committed as ever to serving public office by the standards and values he instilled in me. Additional seats in this audience were left empty tonight at my request as a visual reminder of the men and women from our community serving with our armed forces across the world and locally through the National Guard and Reserves. Their commitment to freedom, to our country, and this community makes possible our form of government and its peaceful transition that we celebrate with tonight's ceremony. To the staff of the City of Auburn, on behalf of the newly sworn-in City Council, I thank you for your service. The last couple of years have brought many challenges, and despite those challenges, you persevered. You continue to stay focused on your work at hand, and the residents of this city thank you. I offer you our firm commitment to work with you as a team through the city manager we will hire this coming year. To the students and staff of Walton Elementary School, thank you for opening your doors to host us. This building and its fields brings back many memories for me growing up just down the street, from pickup football games with friends to my failed attempts to learn how to ice skate. And finally, being among the last ninth grade classes to earn my green Walton Warriors letter. This building has a special meaning to me, to the city, and to this neighborhood. And of course, its namesake, Mayor Fred Walton, was born and raised in this same neighborhood. Dying at the young age of 41, Mayor Walton was active in all aspects of this community. From his roots and his family's New Auburn Bakery, his leadership with the New Auburn Community Association, and his involvement with the state fair. Becoming mayor shortly after turning 33, Fred Walton had a deep commitment to his neighborhood and to his city. He believed that civic involvement extended well beyond service in elected office, and that neighborhood groups, like the New Auburn Community Association of the early 1900s, perpetuated the ideals of good citizenship. Upon his death, only a few months after the Great New Auburn Fire, and having accepted a leadership role in the Redevelopment Corporation seeking to rebuild this neighborhood, the then president of the New Auburn Association was quoted as saying that Walton was not merely a leader in ideas, but in the endless work that makes community betterment a success. Many of our newly elected councilors ran for office on a platform of civil discourse and teamwork. But having met with each of them, it excites me to know that they are not just going to be leaders in ideas, but also leaders in commitment to the endless work necessary to make this city great. I pledge to you tonight that, along with these councilors, Auburn will make a renewed commitment to civic engagement and community involvement at all levels. From the hallways and classrooms of our schools, to the rooms of ward meetings, and ultimately to Auburn Hall itself. This City Council is ready to step into their roles as policymakers, not individual city councilors. As the chair of this team, I've committed to supporting them in researching and seeking solutions in partnership with the city staff who will manage its implementation. I will support and encourage them as they tackle the challenges of today to create the opportunities of tomorrow. And just as the Littles, Moses, Josiah, and Edward, Benjamin Bates, Albert Kelsey, and many of Lewis and Auburn's initial architects laid out a long-term plan to build a vibrant commercial, industrial, and residential community, the same must be done today with the reality of a 21st century economy as the backdrop. Building such a community will command five key ingredients: a solid educational system supported by modern facilities, transportation infrastructure that will support the efficient movement of residents, visitors, and goods to and from this region, a thriving arts, cultural, and recreational scene, a housing stock that meets the needs of our most vulnerable residents, but also young entrepreneurs, empty nesters, and families. And finally, a toolkit of economic development programs that will retain and grow existing businesses in our city and strategically recruit companies well-suited to what we hope to be. Providing a strong educational foundation in any community positions that community to attract businesses and families and improves the overall quality of life for residents. If we are to become a city that embraces education as that cornerstone, then this new school committee and this new city council must work together hand in hand to make education Auburn's number one priority. To that end, I will propose a joint workshop between the new city council and school committee before the end of January to discuss a joint workshop schedule for the entire year. Agenda item number one will be addressing the school facilities master plan. Prior school committees and city councilors neglected real capital improvement programs for our schools. In this two-year term, I will push for the adoption of a joint resolution laying out a process to collectively identify and move towards implementation of a solution for our educational facilities. We are facing very real challenges of addressing an aging Edward Little High School and providing for lifelong education that will ensure a trained workforce to support economic development. We need to shift from the time when school committee and city council operated independently. Our challenges require collaboration among these two bodies at a level that has not been seen in recent memory. Despite our status as Maine's second largest urban area and being home to the state's largest dry goods port at the Auburn Intermodal Facility, a national transportation group recently released top 50 projects for the state of Maine, totaling billions of dollars in need, had Lewis and Auburn nowhere near the top 25. Billions in proposed investment priorities for Maine, LA identified for only $10 million. Our failed local advocacy has left us on the outside, not any longer. For the movement of our residents and potential investors and visitors, I propose that Lewis and Auburn focus on making three major links, not to each other, but rather to our urban partner to the south, Portland. I will work with this council and city staff to investigate the creation of a commuter bus service between downtown Portland and downtown Lewis and Auburn. A recent Maine DOT study concluded federal investment into such a service should be made along the coast to Brunswick, where a free interstate and a soon-to-be-launched rail service exists. This is not acceptable. Lewis and Auburn residents already pay to use our section of the interstate, increasing commuter costs, and our downtown households have among the lowest rates of car ownership in the state. Unfortunately, an antiquated federal policy creates a bias towards chasing wealthy commuters down the coast over linking communities where populations may be lacking vehicles, may be unemployed, or underemployed. These types of flaws in state and federal policy that put Lewis and Auburn at a disadvantage must be addressed. And this includes either removing the toll north of Portland or finally putting a toll on 295. As we push for regular bus service from our downtown to Portland, we should also include a link from our community to one of the Northeast's most affordable commercial airports, the Portland International Jetport. After undergoing a more than $80 million expansion, easy access from the heart of our community to dozens of national hubs should be seen as an opportunity, not competition. And following a decade of watching passenger rail advocacy send the Downeaster up the coast, momentum has emerged to create intercity passenger rail from Portland to Auburn and then Bethel and on to Montreal. Working with partners, Auburn will play a leadership role in making access to passenger rail a priority at the state and federal level. When it comes to quality of life, the stigma of Lewiston Auburn as a cultural wasteland is over. And while those who have not yet visited to experience our renaissance still may have their doubts, we should celebrate the diverse offerings this community has and find ways to further support its growth. The presence of a community-based theater in our downtown, our own community concert band, an art wall, the quality of lectures and programming from the Androscoggin Historical Society, the stately mansion of the Women's Literary Union, and the riverfront setting of the Night House and Shoe Shop by Auburn Heritage all contribute to the character of our city. They are testaments to where we've come from and position us to where we want to be. And that's not even an exhaustive list. Add to that an equity theater, a church-turned performing arts venue, a film festival, an art walk, a new museum prepared to rise from the banks of the river in downtown Lewiston, and our community now has cultural offerings to rival most cities in New England. The only question is which rooftops do we need to shout it from, and what role can our jointly funded arts agency, LA Arts, play in that going forward? For recreation, I'm excited to add City Hall to the list of places that I can commute by a kayak. We should conclude quickly that recreation and its potential along the Androscoggin River is another important focus for growing our community. In a state known as vacation land, the next few years will see Lewiston Auburn and our major river becoming a major regional attraction for all New England. After the New England Governors Conference recently placed the Androscoggin as one of seven priority pathways in all of New England. This riverfront and the revitalized downtown offers the backdrop to build a very attractive mix of workforce and market-rate housing. The most significant challenge, however, is the age of our housing stock, particularly in downtown. With a depressed real estate market, it is becoming hard for private investors to make a profit and adequately invest in modernizing their buildings. Our new downtown employers providing good-paying jobs for professionals in service and healthcare industries could benefit from being able to promote the opportunity to live and work in the same neighborhood. With no citywide housing policy, determining the right mix of market rate to low-income housing when providing public incentives simply does not exist. This leaves most new housing investments focused almost exclusively on low-income or income-capped units. As has been stated by the Young Professionals of the Lewiston Auburn area in their downtown policy statement, and by Lewiston's own Riverfront Island consultant, our downtown area needs a greater amount of market-rate housing. In speaking with my counterpart in Lewiston, Mayor-elect Bob McDonald, we have agreed in the new year to create a joint committee on downtown housing to assess the existing conditions of housing in downtown Lewiston Auburn. We must identify the challenges and opportunities seen by those investing in and owning real estate and consider how we might set a shared course to improve investment in housing regardless of city lines. While in the past, joint efforts between Lewiston and Auburn have focused almost exclusively on consolidating departments, I'm excited by the prospect of moving collaborative efforts towards shared policy making, regardless of our city boundaries. Lewiston Auburn must be seen by those that live here and those from away as a place where creativity thrives and is supported. Small business development must be placed on stronger footing when compared to the capacity of our cities currently leveraged towards industrial and commercial growth. Those communities that have built a strong small business network and fostered innovation have fared much better in this recession. Lewiston Auburn must take that course. Neither Auburn nor Lewiston have a council-adopted economic development strategy. Yet we both staff our own economic development departments and co-fund a shared economic development agency. The limited resources at our disposal must be directed for maximum benefit, from financing incentives for locating businesses, using public funds to match private startup capital, or public staff support in business consultation, we must set a tone.